now we discussed different type of optical fiber, their application in the area of communication, and then in area of sensing. In the first session I also showed one slide on photonic crystal fiber also. So this is also a new class of optical fiber. You know, with the conventional single mode fiber, we have problem sometimes a single mode behavior shift to a multi-mode behavior if there is a change of wavelength or change of some parameter. Then further also for dispersion shifted fiber, dispersion flattened fiber, dispersion compensating fiber. So different type of fibers are there. Even yesterday, Professor Savra, he also introduced a slide on fiber with multi-cores. So 12 core fiber, but in different structure. So photonic crystal fiber is a very, very special class of optical fibers. So when you talk about a crystal, and we know in a crystal, there is always a regular structure. But the fiber which were introduced yesterday, that was not in the regular fashion. The aim was to minimize the crosstalk. So but these class of fiber, although they were introduced in late 1996, but still lot of issues are there with optical fiber because they are also the multi-core in a particular structure. It may be solid core, or it may be hollow core. All these issues are there. So they have many manufacturing issues also. On the other hand, they have many benefit over the conventional fiber. So as a result, they have application not mostly used in the communication, but they find wide application in area of sensors. So for this session, we have us, Randhir Bhatnagar. He is chief scientist and also head of the photonic division, or now it is the advanced material and sensing systems at their place. So he is looking after this photonic section there. So CSIO is a branch of CSIR, and now at this place they have very good photonic area. And yesterday Dr. Umesh Tiwari was here to discuss speak over the fiber optic sensor in general. So but this is a very, very special class of sensor, and Bhatnagar ji, he is working specifically on these photonic crystal fibers in the area of sensing. So he will discuss in this part what are the benefits and what are the limitations and what are the different applications of optical photonic crystal fiber. I'm thankful to Bhatnagar ji for accepting my invitation, and he be with us for sharing his experiences. He's looking after all those activities. Number of students are working under him to develop this project, different projects in the area of photonic crystal fiber. And I find this session will be very, 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 very interesting and very, very useful. So because this is a new class of optical fiber, we are all interested to know how they can be utilized in many applications. So I request Bhatnagar ji to start the session.
Thanks, Professor Chaudhary, and good morning to you all. So the topic is photonic crystal fiber benefits and applications. So the lecture outline is conventional optical fiber, photonic crystal fiber, PCB fabrication techniques, application of PCF, photonic crystal fiber as sensor, super continuum generation, and high power delivery. As we know, the classical optical fiber works in the principle of total internal reflection, where you have a core with a high refractive index and a cladding with a slightly lower refractive index, and the variation in the refractive index of the core and cladding is very minimum, of the order of 10 to the power minus 4. And that gives you a total internal reflection. The type of fibers are multimode fibers, which is used for short range, and many paths are allowed, many modes can be propagated. And then you have another class, which is single mode fiber, where the dia of the core is reduced to such a dimension that only one mode is allowed to propagate. It can be used for long range, and modal dispersion is less. So these are the classes of optical fiber which are classical and currently being used. But there are certain limitations onto this, that you can't bend this fiber. Say you can't bend this fiber to a radius which is less than 30 mm, because then the the modes which are propagating in the core gets coupled into cladding and gets lost. That means there is a intensity loss at the output end. Then there is a dispersion, which means the broadening of the opticals over the optical power, over the length of the fiber. Then there are non-linear effects, which is self-phase modulation. This is a non-linear phase modulation of a beam caused by its own intensity via Kerr effect. Kerr effect is related to polarization, which is related to your electric field in a non-linear fashion. That means you can't launch a high-power laser beam through the optical fiber. That means the wavelength which you launch in the optical fiber gets converted into a different wavelength, or the band will get increased. Then the guidance of high power is not possible using such type of fibers. So there is a limitation on to the this class of fibers. So let me first discuss what is photonic crystal, how to arrive that theoretically. So we know this Bragg law. If we have a periodic structure, and then when a beam falls onto it at an angle theta, it gets scattered, and then the coherency of this, or constructive interference of this, is proportional to n lambda is equal to 2 the sine theta. Yeah, n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta, where d is the spacing between the two layers. And then there is a periodicity, whether it is a crystal, whether it is any other material, which is periodic, and this law is followed. So now think of a system where you have this type of periodicity, where there is a dielectric slabs. When I say dielectric slabs, means there is a difference in the refractive index periodically with a spacing d, right? So now think of a situation, if the periodicity of this dielectric is correspond to the period of the wavelength, then it starts reflecting. The reflected waves are in phase, and that means they create a standing wave which do not propagate inside. If the beam which is falling onto this such type of periodic structure having a different wavelength, then it can pass through this such a structure. So that means there is a two conditions. One, that if the periodicity matches to the wavelength, if the periodicity don't matches to the wavelength, right? If the periodicity don't matches to the wavelength, it passes. If it is matches, it gets reflected, or it is not passed through that material. So that is the basic. So this is what is one-dimensional photonic crystals. We have come across yesterday also, you might have heard from Dr. Umesh Tiwari, fiber Bragg grating. It is also a one-dimensional photonic crystals. So the photonic crystal is a novel class of optical media represented by natural or artificial structure with periodic modulation of the refractive index. Depending on the geometry of the structure, this photonic crystal can be divided into three categories: one-dimensional, two-dimensional, and three-dimensional. So one-dimensional is, that means there is a periodicity variation across the one dimension and the y direction, say. The periodic modulation of the permittivity or the refractive index occurs in one direction only, while in other two directions, the structure is uniform, Bragg grating or anti-reflecting coating on the optical surfaces. We always use anti-reflection coatings onto the optical surface or mirrors or lenses so that the light don't get reflected. So if we see the Bragg mirror, which is a one-dimensional photonic crystals, it consists of a alternating high and low refractive index profiles, right? With a quarter wavelength. Now, if you see the reflective profile of such a structure, you will see the band gap. That means wavelength from this range to this range is reflected, 100% reflected, right? The propagation light of light over a particular wavelength range is forbidden. That means it is not allowed through such a structures because of the refractive index variation of high and low. If I continues to increase this refractive index, the ratio, if I increase NH to NL, like 2.6, 2.4, 2.2, and 2.0, where the lower one is 1.5, then you can see the band gap, the wavelength range over which it gets reflected is increasing, right? So that means I can control my reflectance or my prohibition of wavelength to be crossing to this such a material by controlling the ratio of high to the low refractive index. Same way, if I keep on increasing that refractive index profile, say if I have four such layers or five such layers, six such layers or 10 layers, you can see that the height of this, that means the reflectance of such a material or such a structure keeps on increasing. Now think of a situation if within this structure, I reduce one of the structure. That means you have a high and low, you have a high and low profile, but all of a sudden in between, I have removed one portion of it. Say two of them I have removed. So what it will happen? That out of that certain band of wavelength, which it is not allowing, it will allow a certain band of wavelength to pass through this. Okay. So you can see here that one particular wavelength is allowed to be passed, allowed to be transmitted, whereas the other bands are not allowed. It is reflected band, right? So that gives me a breakup. That gives me a breakup that by breaking the symmetry or periodicity of a material, it is possible to create a new type of structures or new type of materials or new type of coatings or crystals, wherein I can allow a certain band of wavelength to be passed, others to be stopped. So that can be possible using any refractive index values, right? So example of 1D photonic crystal fiber, 1D photonic crystal is Bragg mirror, which I have explained just now. Vertical cavity surface emitting lasers. You have seen a similar type of lasers where you have coated a such type of structures which is not allowing a particular wavelength to emit. Only a certain band of wavelength is allowed to be emitted so that the monochromaticity is increased. Then the omnidirectional mirrors, which is allowing all the angle of reflections to be possible with a minimum loss, right? You have a classical mirror which allows reflection but with an optical loss. You have a metallic mirror which is again with an optical loss. And then you have a omnidirectional mirror, which is based on this such type of crystals, such type of structure, which is allowing all reflections at all angles with minimum loss. And then there is an omni guide, which is a hollow core. Hollow means it's an air guide, but with a different refractive index circular like this, right? The refractive index profile is like this. Now this allows the guidance of light through the such type of guide. So light guide in the air core of hollow tube confinement based on multi-layer films that constitute the cloud. So one is structure is that you have a structures like high and low refractive index profile. Another one, you have created a circular waveguides wherein it is allowing the light to propagate through air also. It is confining the light. So the one can see on this in the 1999 light wave technology paper. Yes. So another area is 2D photonic crystal fiber. So when we have say 1D photonic crystal fiber, we have a refractive index profile which is varying in the one direction. In this direction, you have two variations in the X and Y directions. Refractive index periodicity is maintained. The pattern on the butterfly thing, we have seen the butterfly phase, which gives a reflection. When you change the angle of your wing, you see different colors are coming out of the butterfly wing or peacock feather. And that is because there is a such type of structures exist. Such type of structures exist onto the butterfly wings, which is of the micron order dimensions. So this reflections, because the light beam is not allowed to pass, a certain band of wavelength is reflected back. So you see different colors coming out of that. So examples of 2D photonic crystals are photo waveguides, photonic crystal lasers, photonic crystal fiber, and add out drop
Add and drop filters. That means you can add or you can drop any wavelengths which you want. So in the same scenario, like we have discussed the 1D photonic crystal fiber, suppose you have a dielectric pattern. You have a dielectric patterns. If you plot the reflectance profile or transmission profile of such a structure, you see the certain band of this has a zero transmissions. It is not allowing the pass the band of these wavelengths. So a periodic array of dielectric cylinders in air forming a two-dimensional band gap. Transmission spectrum of this periodic lattice, as it shows, a full 2D band gap is observed in the wavelength range of 0.22 micron to 0.38 microns. So that means I can create a 2D structure where I can allow certain band of wavelength to be passed and others to be totally reflected back. Now again, if I remove a portion of that, out of that symmetry, if I remove this, you can see certain band wavelength of that is allowed to pass. That means I can allow a selective wavelength of light to be propagated through such a structure. So if a defect is introduced into the system by removing one of the cylinders or a dielectric media, this will lead to localization of a mode in the gap at the site of defect site. Transmission peak is observed in the forbidden band. This corresponds to the defect state, which leads to the special localization of light. So these are the examples of this. You can see a 2D waveguides where you can create such a structures which allows a certain wavelength of light to be passed, others to be blocked. That means integrated optics or integrated photonics type of structures possible using such type of photonic band gap fibers or photonic band gap crystals. The other domain is the 3D photonic crystals, where the refractive index is varying all periodically in all the three dimensions. So the dielectric function is periodic in all three directions. Very few periodic arrangement of such materials exist in nature. Artificial is also being possible. Like opal, it's a stone which shows a 3D periodic photonic crystal presence in that. You can see the inside. When you rotate this opal stone, you can see different colors are coming out. It's because of that, the periodicity or the refractive index profile or the dielectric behavior or periodic dielectric behavior in the crystal itself. See, the optical properties of photonic crystals are determined by the existence of the periodic modulation of the refractive index of the medium. So one thing is very clear, that if you have a periodic refractive index variation, and then if you create a void in that, then if certain bands are allowed to pass, others are totally blocked. So the concept of photonic band gap is similar to the what we have seen in a semiconductor. In a semiconductor, you have a silicon structures which has a particular band gaps. It will not allow the electrons which is having an energy equivalent to the band gap to transport from valence band to the conduction band. But moment you dope it, it will allow electrons to acquire energy to pass through that material, semiconductor. So if the periodicity of the lattice is broken by missing silicon atom or by various impurity, an electron can have enough energy to be in the band gap. Same is the situation in the photonic crystals, that if you create a band where you have created a void in that, so it allows the photons to transfer, whereas the other photons, other wavelengths are not allowed to be transferred. So you can see in the energy gap in a semiconductor, you have a band gap here, you have a valence band. If the electrons tries to move in a structure of where you have a periodicity of potential energy of different atoms, then you can see that there exists a energy gap or band gap. So only when you dope it, it allows the electrons to transport it through this media. Same is the situation in photonic crystal, that it is possible to create a photon transportation through such a material by creating a void in that. So if you compare the semiconductor with a photonic crystal, you can see the periodic array of atoms
which is of the order of 5 nanometer, 0.5 nanometer, whereas the periodic variation of dielectric is of the order of 0.5 micron, which is of the order of wavelength of light. So it works on the atomic length scale, whereas it works on the length scale of wavelength. These are the natural structures. These are artificial structures. One can create these structures by coating different refractive index profiles. It can control the electron flow, whereas it controls the electromagnetic wave propagations. It's a new class of optics, which is now currently coming up much larger, in a much larger fashion. So one must understand how this PBG is formed, how photonic band gap is formed. You can see there is a lattice, there is a dielectric, and then there is a air structure. There is a dielectric, there is a high refractive index, there is a low refractive index. So this type of structure is existing. Now, whenever there is a structure of this type of behavior is present in the material, you see that there are two types of scattering which is taking place. One is the Bragg scattering, which is a macroscopic Bragg resonance, which is from a periodic array of scatterers. That means all those cylinders or those dielectrics which are present periodically. This leads to the electromagnetic stop gaps when the wave propagates in the direction of a periodic modulation, when an integer number of half wavelength coincides with the lattice spacing A of the dielectric microstructures. That means Bragg wavelength is maximum whenever this periodicity is matches with the half wavelength of the wavelength incident onto this. The another one is because this periodic crystals or structures or cylinders, they are having a dimension equal to the wavelength of light. So that means there will be a my scattering also because of that presence of such structures. So that means second is a microscopic scattering resonance from a single unit cell of the material. The maximum backage scattering occurs when precisely 1/4 of the wavelength coincides with the diameter 2R of a single dielectric well of refractive index N. So that means there are two scattering which is taking place in such a structures. One is a Bragg scattering, another one is a my scattering because of the cylinders, which is having its dimension equal to the wavelength of light. And then when the two coincides such a way that the resonance occurs at certain wavelengths, then it starts reflecting back. So that is the cut of the PBG formations. So PBG formation is enhanced by choosing the materials parameters A, which is the pitch spacing, the R, the dimension of the or dia of the cylinder or dielectric material, and the refractive index. That means it is possible to create any PBG for any wavelengths by choosing the pitch, the dia, and the refractive index, right? So this is the cut of the problem. That means I can allow certain bands to be passed, I cannot allow certain wavelengths to be not passed. So the size scales, say for us corresponding to 1 millimeter refractive index periodicity, I can have a photonic band gap in the terahertz. For 1 micron, I can have a band gap in mid-IR region, ranging from 3 micron to 10 micron. If I have a band gap of RI periodicity of 0.5 micron, I can have a photonic band gap in the region of near IR, in the region of 1550 or 1300 range. If it is 0.1 micron, it is in the visible region. That means I can create any wavelength reflection using such a structures, using such a technique. So these are the following PBG materials: photonic band gap materials, silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide, indium phosphides. So brief history shows that a Bragg waveguide, which is air structures, like we have seen in a classical fiber where you have a total internal reflection following the Snell's law, whereas in this situation you have an air core which is allowing the light to pass, right? So 1970s, cylindrical Bragg waveguide can guide light. In 1991, idea that light could be trapped inside a 2D photonic crystal fiber made of silica capillaries, right? So this is how the idea keeps on generating to create a photonic crystal fiber also. Then the theoretical proof comes, which says the band gap building is guiding is possible.
1996, first PCF, photonic crystal fiber prototype, has come out by stacking silica capillaries and then drawing this into a fiber with an index guidance. And the here, the hole and the pitch of the spacing is controlled to 0.2. And in 1991, the first hollow core photonic crystal fiber has arrived. So this is the basic brief history. Let we now switch over to the photonic crystal fiber. So we have seen this single mode fiber, which is a standard fiber, where you have a total internal reflections. So it is now a photonic crystal fiber, which is having a core and a cladding is a hollow cores. A cladding is having a number of holes, which is air holes, and then you are creating a modified total in internal reflection within such a system. So one system is that you have a core, you have a cladding with a continuous material presence, another structure that you have a core, and then the cladding is hollow in the sense you have a air pockets. The cladding structure is having a air pockets all along the length of the fiber, running all along the length of the fiber like this. So that means now the cladding refractive index is approximately of the dimension of the air, and the core is a silica fiber or silica type materials. The solid core fiber developed in 1996. So it is a modified total internal reflections. The central hole is absent. High index defects as a solid core or solid PCF. The core has, the other one is in place of this solid core, I can have a air core also. The core has an extra hole, which is a low index defect, which is a photonic band gap effect. That means you can have either a solid core, which is made of silica, or you can have air holes all along the running along the fiber. This light is guided along the low refractive index air by a photonic gap confinement effect. So if you see here, this is a solid core. That means the core is solid, but the cladding is having a number of air pockets or air capillaries running all along the length. This delta is the pitch, D is the dia of the core, and D is the dimension of the air cladding structures. Another area is hollow core, which is based on band gap guiding effect. That means now the light is propagating through this air core through a band gap guiding. That means you have created a structure in the periodicity. That means you think of a situation that you have a number of air holes all across the cladding, but suddenly you have removed a number of holes in the cladding to create a hole core. That means now the band which is not allowed by the cladding is allowed by the core, the center portion of that. So roughly 7 or 19 of such air holes are removed from the center to create a core. So by varying the size, location of the holes, mode shape, dispersion, nonlinearity, etc., can be changed. That means I can maneuver my fiber characteristics by varying the pitch, the core dimensions, the cladding dimensions, or the dia of the air core to change the mode shape, dispersion, nonlinearity, etc. I can change. And any wavelength I can reflect, or any wavelength I can allow to pass. So let's me discuss now hollow core photonic crystal fiber. In this fiber, you have both. The core is like this. You have both reflection and refractions with a Mie scattering and a Bragg scattering. When they do coincides each other, you have a total transmission of power. Roughly of 98% of the light is propagated through the core of such fiber. So that means any light which I launch at the input is made to be available to me at the hollow core of the fiber, right? So that means now a new class of fiber has come out, and NKT Photonics, it's in Holland, they are the sole manufacturer of this fiber, who is producing this. And this fiber, since it is hollow, the air holes are there, I can make use of this fiber for spectroscopic analysis. That means if I allow some of the gases or liquids to pass through this fiber, as well as my light also to interact in the fiber, then it can be used as a sensor stone, right? So that means this fiber is can replace the bulk spectroscopic equipment also. So the light is guided in air core instead of traditional high refractive index core, which is in single mode fiber, allows for lower losses because there is no material exist. It's a air. So the air shows no loss. So maximum light transportation is possible. That means I can allow more power of laser to be transported through the such fibers. Whereas in another fibers of single mode fiber, it is not possible because of nonlinear effects which comes in. And it confines the light in fiber. You can see here, the maximum light is confined in the core of the such fiber. And currently 1.2 dB per kilometer traditional fibers are existing in the market. NKT is making this. So light confinement by photonic band gap effect, which I have explained earlier in 1D or 2D or 3D photonic crystal. Index of core can be lower than that of cladding because it's now air. Light is transmitted through core with high efficiency even around tight bands. That means I can now bend this fiber because now there is nothing like evanescent wave or something like that. So that means the light is propagated in the core itself and the bending will not affect this light propagations. High power transmission without nonlinear optical effect because it's mostly air. Small material dispersion, nonlinear interaction in gas-filled air holes. That means if I fill this air holes with the gas, I can create a nonlinear interaction also possible. So this is how the loss of PCF right from 1999, and the University of Bath has generated this theoretically. And then it has been produced by Blaze Photonics and now is being taken over by the NKT Photonics. So it can be used in chemical sensing, gas-based nonlinear optics, high power delivery, pulse compressions. So these are the application of this. Another area is the solid core PCF. You have a solid core here and then again surrounded by a perforated cladding. Again, the transmission is through total internal reflections, modified total internal reflections. The effective index of cladding is close to the air, which is n equals 1. Again, the anomalous dispersion over a wide range, wavelength range is possible. So that means it allows solution transmission to be possible in such fibers, which is not possible in single mode fiber. And then one can tailor this zero dispersion wavelength for phase matching condition in nonlinear optical processes, that is super continuum generation or four-way mixing like process. That means I can tune my this type of structures. It can be honeycomb structure, it can be a triangular structure, it can be a circular structure. I can tune this, I can vary this refractive index profile across this to shift this zero dispersion wavelength all across the wavelength of light. That is possible. And then it is also possible to have a single mode operation, which is endlessly single mode operation using a V number which is of the order of 2.4505. Single mode for wide wavelength range is possible with a large core dia, which is not possible in a single mode fiber. Right? Here you can have a large core dia possible. And this is the transmission loss, which is comparable to the single mode fiber, which is 0.18 dB per kilometer. NTT has made this. So it had started from 240 dB per kilometer. Now it has touched 2.1. 8 dB per kilometer. So now I'll switch over to the fabrications. The fabrication process is similar to what the single mode fiber is performed. Here you take capillaries. You have a solid core. You take the capillaries, assemble that in a hexagonal configurations, and then pull it at a high temperature in a preformed shape. So roughly of around 3 cm of this is now first pulled to around 1 mm of this and then it is being stacked to the conventional fiber drying machine and then pulled to the photonic crystal fiber by controlling the dia and the temperature. So the preform is heated to 2000 degrees centigrade to soften silica. The resulting preform is reduced to fiber dimensions using a conventional fiber drawing tower with collapse ratio of 50,000. In the first run, the 3 mm cane is reduced to 1 mm cane, 1 mm dia. In the second run, cane is introduced inside a jacketed tube and drawn to the final fiber. It is like this. It is drawn to the final fiber. It is jacketed with a polymer. So this is the feed and holder. It's a similar to what the conventional fiber optics, optical fiber cable is drawn, that you have a feed and screw holder, preform furnace, 2000 degree centigrade, and then the diameter control. You have a cane drying system here, and then it is coated with a polymer, and then it is rotated like on the wheel to get it. So the fabrication of capillaries, preform stacking, drawing preform into a cane first, and then the second cane, and then pulling it down. So this is the conventional, like what we did in the single mode fiber. Same process is followed, but here capillary stacking is the main challenge. And then the holes dimensions has to be maintained all along the fiber length. Now, because of this, now there are different types of PCFs now exist based on the applications which is demanded. You have a photonic crystal fiber. It can be also called as microstructure fiber because of microstructure structures available on the cladding side. It has a high index core or index guiding mechanism or a holate type of structures or hole assisted. So this is the core with a solid core. And the subclass is that you can create high numerical aperture of the order of 0.7, which is not possible in a conventional one. Large mode area is possible. And then one can create a high nonlinear fiber, PCF fiber, using such techniques. In the photonic band gap, which is a SCPCF, hollow core photonic crystal, you can create a low index core. That means you can further subdivide this hollow structure into a number of holes, or you can create an air guiding hollow core. So these are the different classes within the PCF exist, which one can use based on the applications. Now, advantages of PCF are there are many physical properties which can be engineered, like power fraction, birefringence, chromatic dispersions. The waveguide dispersion can be engineered to have the zero dispersion wavelength at any desired wavelength. This is useful for nonlinear applications where normal dispersion is a limiting factor. By changing the core diameter of fiber, the zero dispersion can be shifted to the visible range. That means anywhere I can tune it. So now PCF can also be filled with gases or liquids for sensing applications. So now I'll switch over to the application where one can make use of this such type of structures. You think of a laser that you have a spontaneous emission which is coming out. Now, if I want to block that spontaneous emission, can I create a structure, photonic band gap structures, onto such a structure which is creating a laser so that such type of emission can be inhibited? It cannot be allowed. So when it is not allowed, you'll have only monochromaticity of the laser which is coming out. So that means you can have low threshold lasers, single mode LEDs, mirrors, optical filters. It is possible using photonic band gap crystals. Same way, if I create a photonic band gap within the cavity itself, here you have a cavity, and then if you create a photonic band gap here itself, then it keep on oscillating within the band gap. It will not be lost. So creates an allowed photon state in the photonic band gap can be used as a cavity in lasers. So these are the applications which one can make use of using these photonic crystals. Another is photonic crystal laser, That means within this, I can create a defect in this so that the laser is allowed to propagate inside this structure. So incorporation of a 2D photonic crystal with light emitting semiconductor quantum wells provides confinement and gain necessary for lasing. That means now it is confining the wavelength or the particular wave which is propagating through this structure, through this active region, is now made to oscillate between these structures. So these are the applications which is coming up using such type of photonic band gap. Another one is super prism effect. We see that if you have a conventional prism, if you launch a light, it gets deviated only slightly, right? But in certain situation where you have a photonic band gap crystals, if you launch a light, if you slightly tilt this angle, you see there is a large dispersion, large variation of angle. So it disperses much larger, up to minus 70 to plus 70. So based on highly anisotropic dispersion by photonic band gap, it is possible to disperse the light to a larger angle as compared to the conventional crystals. So this type of structure, this type of prism, one can make use of in wavelength demultiplexer, where you want to deviate the multiplex wavelength into a different angle rotation, angle positions. So one of the application is again super prism creation. Then artificial opals, like you see this opal, when you tilt this opal because of 3D photonic crystal, it gives you reflection at different wavelengths. So one can create that type of structures using material such materials. So chemical synthesis using chemical vapor deposition and wet etch to form air spheres surrounded by silicon shells, easier to achieve smaller dimensions. So it is possible to create artificial opals also. Then again, photonic crystal filters. So if you have a number of wavelengths which is coming from this, if you create a defect so that only one particular wavelength is emitted out, the others are transmitted. Same way, we can create another defect so that the another wavelength comes out and the others are transmitted. That means now I can tune my filters using such type of structures, such a type of Holley structure or microstructures. So add drop filter for a dense wavelength division multiplexing for optical communication system is possible using such type of microstructures. So multiple streams of data are carried at different frequencies, say F1, F2, by shown with a yellow color, enter the optical microchip from an external optical fiber and are carried through a waveguide channel, missing row of pores. Here you can see there is a missing row of pores. That means there are no holes onto this. So data streams at frequency F1 or wavelength F1 or F2 tunnel into localized defect modes and retreat to different destinations. So the frequency of the drop filter is defined by the defect pore diameter. So that means I can select any wavelengths to be dropped using dye of the pore. Is different from the pore diameter of the background photonic crystal fibers. So that means I can choose different dimension of these holes to select different filters or different wavelengths to come out of that. So it can be used as a drop filters for this. Now if I drop this material, the core of that, with a photochromatic material, then the same fiber, the PCF itself, can be used as a fiber grating. I can write a grating structure onto this PCF structure to sense strain, pressure, vibration, temperature, and biosensing. Yesterday, Dr. Tiwari might have talked to you in detail on the fiber gratings, but the same situation can be possible in photonic crystal fiber, which can be used for sensing these parameters. Then, as I said, SCPCF can be used for gas sensing or liquid sensing. The hollow core photonic crystal fiber must match the absorption band of the gases. The gases also have absorption bands. Each gas absorbs a particular wavelength, and then it's at second harmonic, third harmonic also absorbs. Like acetylene, ammonia, carbon dioxide, methane, they also have a absorption bands in the region of 1500 to 1700 nanometer range. Like acetylene is 1537, methane is 1666 or 1653 nanometer. So what we need a SCPCF which allows that particular wavelength to pass through. That means the core structure has to be maintained such that that particular band is allowed, other bands are not allowed, right? That is possible. And then I can use tunable laser to tune this wavelength corresponding to the absorption band of these gases. And then I have to couple between SMF and the PCF to diffuse gas and the light to the fiber. So this is the project which I was executing right now at CSIU. You have a SCPCF fiber which is allowing the wavelength from 1500 to 1700 nanometer to be passed through this optical fiber procured from NKT Photonics. It has a band gap of the refractive index is 1.545 and the N2 is approximately of the air. And this is the absorption band of the methane. You can see 1.66, there is a sharp peak or Q line which absorbs, the methane absorbs at 1.66 nanometer. So if I have a laser, if I have a tunable laser across this point, 1.66, and if I have a fiber which allows this particular wavelength to pass through, then I can create a setup, I can create a sensor system which will gives me a sensing of that particular gas using such a structure. So what is that structure? You have a DFB laser corresponding to 1666 nanometer. You have a single mode fiber. From this, you have a single mode fiber. You have a small PCF fiber of 2 meter length, which is this fiber, allowing this particular wavelength, 1666 nanometer, to be passed through. Then you have a, again a single mode fiber, and which is coupled to the photodiode, right? Now I am allowing the gas to pass through such a structure. There is gap between the single mode fiber and the PCF fiber, which is a hollow core. So now I am allowing the gas to get into this, and the light from here is also coupled to the PCF. A gap is maintained of the order of 7 micron or 10 micron, and now the light as well as the gas both gets coupled into the PCF, which is approximately 2 meter in length, a hair-like structure which can be coiled into a small dimension. And now the light which is coming from the laser is passed through such a gas cell, is passed to the photodiode. Now if I pass the different concentration of methane through such a structure, through such a gas cell, then the absorption because of the methane is possible. To sense the methane absorption is possible. So what I have done, I have passed the gases of different concentration of methane, like you can see here. Now the absorption profile of methane is like this. It is having approximately 300 picometer bandwidth. Because of collisional broadening, pressure broadening, like that, the profile of methane is not a sharp band, but it's a broad band, approximately 300 picometer. So what I did, I have taken a laser, I have tuned this laser all across the absorption profile of the methane. Now this methane profile is 300 nanometer. This is around femtometer laser bandwidth. Now I'm tuning this with a current and a temperature. So as it moves from this point to this point, at one particular point, this laser coincides with the minima or absorption, maximum absorption of the methane, right? So if I modulate this laser, if I am at this point, if F is the frequency of modulation of the laser, you can see if it is at this point, you can see the F frequency is available to me in the intensity profile at the detector output. If I slowly tune this at this point, you can see at this point, the frequency F is converted into 2F. So that means even though I don't know what is the maximum absorption of the methane, but I can tune this laser across the band profile of the methane. And whenever I get the 2F component, the second harmonic of the fundamental frequency of modulation, I can come to know, yes, I am at the maximum absorption peak of the methane or any gases. That means this is what is called tunable diode laser absorption spectroscopy, a new class of spectroscopy, which is 10,000 times more sensitive as compared to the existing direct absorption spectrophotometers. So once I have such a system built in with me, I can now pass this laser at this wavelength and different concentration of gases. And now I am using a lock-in detection system for sensing the second harmonic of the output of the at the photodiode. And then you can see as the concentration of the methane changes, the absorption profile or the concentration or the amplitude of the second harmonic also keeps on changing. So I can plot this second harmonic amplitude versus the concentration. So approximately 500 ppm is possible to be detected using such a system. So this system exists in my lab right now. So we are now on to it for carbon dioxide sensing, oxygen sensing, acetylene sensing. So there are lot many queries and projects are being in pipeline because this can be used in petrochemical, it can be used in the aircraft for oxygen sensing because pilot breathes oxygen. So they need, because the one of the advantages is it's a non-interactive. Non-interactive in the sense there is nothing like a semiconductor material present which senses the gases. Wherein in semiconductor you have to heat the material to sense the gases because the conductivity or resistivity of that material changes. Here it is only light and the gas interaction. So there is no need to have a high temperature operation in that situation. So this type of work exists in my lab. Another area is the supercontinuum generation. That means if you have a pulse of one wavelength, can we create a number of wavelengths out of it? That means can we create a supercontinuum? That means a wavelength ranging from one wavelength to the end of the wavelength or 1600, say in this case 400 to 1600 or maybe higher wavelength range. Is it possible? This is possible using such type of structure, PCF structures. You can see AC light source, amplified spontaneous emission light source. The profile is like this. The power output is like this. You can see the incandescent lamp, which is giving the output like this. You can have a LED or SLEDs, whose output is again confined to this. Again, laser output is also monochromatic. So one needs to have a high power, a supercontinuum source, meaning by it can range from one wavelength to the another range. And that range should be tunable by selecting the structure, by selecting the material. So supercontinuum generation is the formation of broad continuous spectra by propagation of high power pulses through nonlinear media. So if I pass a high power laser pulse through a nonlinear media, it is possible to create supercontinuum generation. The term supercontinuous does not cover a specific phenomena, but rather a plethora of nonlinear effects, which in combination leads to extreme pulse broadening. So this is the basic concept. You have a pulse laser, you have a PCF fiber, and then you create a supercontinuum generation. That means all wavelengths are existing in that system. So formation of broad continuous spectra through propagation of short high power pulse through zero dispersion wavelength of the nonlinear media. That means now I have created a fiber whose zero dispersion wavelength matches with the pulse laser wavelength, right? If I can tune this wavelength with the zero dispersion wavelength of the fiber, then the nonlinear effect takes place and then you create a supercontinuum generation. The determining factors for generation of supercontinuum are dispersion of the fiber relative to the pumping wavelength, the pulse length, and the peak power. So these are the determining factors which generates the supercontinuum. So supercontinuum generation is the combined response of various nonlinear effects such as self-phase modulation, Raman effect, four-way mixing, and soliton dynamics. So it's a combination of all these parameters. So when pumping with femtosecond pulses in the normal dispersion region, self-air modulation dominates with Raman scattering, broadening to the long wavelength side. So Raman scattering gives you a long wavelength side. The output from the normal dispersion pumping changes dramatically when the pump is moved, and the wavelength of pump laser is moved closer to the zero dispersion wavelength. And other nonlinear effects also start superspreads, which is self-phase modulation or four-wave mixing. So supercontinuum light can be best described as a broad as lamp, bright as a laser. So it is in between. So it is covering the broad spectrum of a lamp, but as well as bright light as compared to the lasers. So this is the typical supercontinuum experimental setup, which is one can see in the Blaze Photonics site application note on supercontinuum generation. You have a femtosecond sapphire laser. You have a photonic crystal fiber whose zero dispersion is matched to the wavelength of this femtosecond laser. And then you have a focusing objective. And then you are analyzing this through a spectrometer. A 12.5 centimeter fiber is pumped at 800 nanometer. The pulse duration is 50 femtosecond. And the average power coupled to this fiber is 67 milliwatt. So that means low power of such value is good enough to generate a supercontinuum. The fiber has normal dispersion at the pumping wavelength and zero dispersion at the 875 nanometers. So moment you tune this wavelength at this wavelength, zero dispersion wavelength, you can see a large supercontinuum process to be taking place. So this is that curve plot at different pump wavelength, 800, 825, 850, 875. You can see at the zero dispersion of 875, so you see the broadening of the femtosecond pulse. No? This whole range it covers. So from 700 to 1200 by using only a 12.5 centimeter of a photonic crystal. So supercontinuum form with pumping at different wavelengths in a thick fiber with zero dispersion at approximately 900 nanometer. The fiber is pumped by 100 femtosecond pulses with a repetition rate of 76 megahertz. So this is how the supercontinuum SLED, xenon lab, helium neon laser, one can see the output of supercontinuum is ranging from one wavelength to the another, and this can be tuned at different wavelength region, even in IR region also, from 3 to 10 micron also, by changing the material and the structure of the PCB. So a supercontinuum source provides ultra broadband white light spectrum, single mode beam characteristics, excellent pointing stability, high brightness, and this type of source is being used in OCT, optical coherence tomography, early cancer, that is being used for early cancer detection, biophotonics, flow cytometry, pump probe experiment, or time resolved spectroscopy. Now, since I said this PCF, one can have a large mode area or large core, it is possible by and then with a single mode operation. You can see if I have a core diameter of 20 or 40 micron, which is not possible in a single mode fiber, which is 8 micron only, I can still have a at such a numerical aperture, I can still have this PCF operated as a single mode region. So that means I can have a larger dia as well as single mode operation. That means I can pass a larger optical power output to such a structure, or I can couple such structures to the laser or the LEDs to couple with maximum light out of that. So effective mode area is increases, waveguide becomes multimode. So there is a trade-off between LMA or large mode area fiber and single mode operation. That means I must select within the numerical aperture and the dia, which one I need to have. So one can design this large mode area fiber with single mode operation by controlling the index difference between core and cladding, tailoring the refractive index profile inside the core using single material photonic crystal fibers. So all these photonic crystal fibers, they are single materials as compared to a conventional one where you have a core material which is doped with the, some impurities or germania, whereas this is only single material which is being used. And the future applications are highly efficient photonic crystal laser is possible, high resolution spectral filters, which I have already discussed, photonic crystal diodes and transistors is also possible, high efficiency light bulbs, optical computers is possible. So with this, I thank you all.